Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to Redeemer Community Church. It's so great to have you all here with us this morning. Welcome to our viewers on the live stream. And you're viewing us on Facebook this morning. We're usually on Facebook and YouTube, but we're having technical difficulties. So if you have a friend who you know was hoping to watch live stream on YouTube this morning, send them a text message and let them know they're going to have to jump on Facebook. We'll get the video on YouTube later. But for you who are joining us via live stream, for you who are here, we're grateful to have you with us this morning. We're grateful for the opportunity to gather as the church of God, as the beloved and redeemed people of God, and celebrate who our God is and what He has done. And as we draw our hearts before Him in worship this morning, we want to begin by looking at Scripture. Psalm 34, verses 4 through 10 will be our Old Testament reading for the morning. And as you all know, if you've been here with us, this is a reading that you participate in together. So it's a little longer this morning. So don't feel bad. I'm going to have to talk way longer than you this morning. So join me and let's read Psalm 34 together, verses 4 through 10. I sought the Lord, and He answered me and delivered me from all my fears. Those who look to Him are radiant, and their faces shall never be ashamed. This poor man cried, and the Lord heard him and saved him out of all his troubles. The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him and delivers them. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who takes refuge in him. Oh, fear the Lord, you his saints, for those who fear him have no lack. The young lions suffer want and hunger, but those who seek the Lord lack no good thing. Amen. Let's go to God in prayer together. Father, we delight this morning to be your people who can testify to the truth of your word, that those who seek you, Father, have no good lack no good thing. We have been abundantly blessed by you, first and foremost by the gift of salvation through your Son, Jesus Christ. You have rescued us as a people from our sins and from our rebellion against you. You have cleansed us from our unrighteousness. You have welcomed us into your family and made us a people who were not a people. So God, we rejoice in who you are and what you've done this morning. We thank you for your blessings. We thank you, God, that we who seek you only do so because you sought us first. Your word tells us, God, that while we were yet sinners, while we were yet in rebellion against you, Jesus Christ died for us. And we thank you, God. We thank you that though we were dead in our trespasses and sins, you have made us alive in Jesus Christ. And you've given us not only life and breath today, but God, you've given us eternal life and abundant joy through Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you for the privilege of gathering with the saints of God and singing songs of praise and worship to you, of hearing and reading the word together, of hearing the word taught. For the blessing this morning, God, we look forward to of gathering around the table and taking communion together. What a privilege and honor it is to be your people, God. We thank you, we praise you, we ask you, God, to be pleased and glorified in what we do this morning and that you would meet with us. Dwell among the presence of your people, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to invite you to stand. We're going to sing songs of worship. I want to give you a quick reminder because this is the first week we're taking communion together at the end of our service. So if you didn't grab communion elements on the way in this morning and you want to observe communion with us at the end of the service, during the next couple of songs, you can slip over there and grab one out of the basket. We'll do that after the sermon. All right, let's worship together.
Well, good morning and welcome. It's so good to see you out there this morning. Let's lift up our voices and sing to the Lord this morning. We're going to start out by singing, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. O Lord, my rock and my redeemer, greatest treasure of my longing soul. My God, like you there is no other. True delight is found in you alone. Your grace, oh well too deep to fathom. Your love exceeds the heaven's reach. Your truth, a fount of perfect wisdom, my highest good and my unending need. O Lord, my rock and my redeemer, strong defender of my weary heart, my sword to fight the cruel deceiver, and my shield against his hateful darts. My song when enemies surround me, my hope when times of sorrows rise, my joy when trials are abounding, your faithfulness, my refuge in the night. O Lord, my rock and my redeemer, gracious Savior of my ruined life, my guilt and cross laid on your shoulder. In my place, you suffered, bled, and died. You rose, the grave and death are conquered. You broke my bond of sin and shame. Oh Lord, my rock and my redeemer, may all my days bring glory to your name. May all my days bring glory to your name. Well, let's continue praising the Lord this morning. We're going to do If We Are the Body.
It's crowded in worship today as she slips in, trying to fade into the faces. The girl's teasing laughter is carrying farther than they know, farther than they know. But we are the body. Why aren't his arms reaching? Why aren't his hands healing? Why aren't his words teaching? And we are the body. Why aren't his feet going? Why is his love not showing them there is a way? There is a way. The traveler is far away from home. He sheds his coat and quietly sinks into the back row. The weight of their judgmental glances tells him that his chances are better out on the road. But we are the body. Why aren't his arms reaching? Why aren't his hands healing? Why aren't his words teaching? And we are the body. Why aren't his feet going? Why is his love not showing them there is a way? Jesus paid much too high a price for us to pick and choose who should come. We are the body of Christ. And we are the body. Why aren't his arms reaching? Why aren't his hands healing? Why aren't his words teaching? And we are the body. Why aren't his feet going? Why is his love not showing them there is a way? Jesus is the way.
Please be seated.
Thank you, Mark, and thank you guys for pressing on with us during some technical difficulties. I know you couldn't hear the guitar very well, but we'll get there, won't we? There was a time when we didn't have all this stuff, right? Microphones and all that complicated stuff to go wrong on Sunday morning, but we're going to focus in on the word of the Lord nevertheless. We're going to read this morning for our New Testament reading together, James chapter 2, verses 1 through 13. James chapter 2, 1 through 13. The words are going to be behind me. You can look it up in your Bible. Follow along as I read this portion of Scripture. My brothers, show no partiality as you hold the faith in our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory. For if a man wearing a gold ring and fine clothing comes into your assembly, and a poor man in shabby clothing also comes in, and if you pay attention to the one who wears the fine clothing and say, "You sit here in a good place," while you say to the poor man, "You stand over there," or "Sit down at my feet," Have you not then made distinctions among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? Listen, my beloved brothers, has not God chosen those who are poor in the world to be rich in faith and heirs of the kingdom, which he has promised to those who love him? But you have dishonored the poor man. Are not the rich ones who oppress you and the ones who drag you into court? Are they not the ones who blaspheme the honorable name by which you were called? If you really fulfill the royal law according to the scripture, you shall love your neighbor as yourself, you are doing well. But if you show partiality, you are committing sin and are convicted by the law as transgressors. For whoever keeps the whole law but fails in one point has become accountable for all of it. For he who said, "Do not commit adultery," also said, "Do not murder." If you do not commit adultery but do murder, you have become a transgressor of the law. So speak and so act as those who are to be judged under the law of liberty. For judgment is without mercy to one who has shown no mercy. Mercy triumphs over judgment. Let's take these words of Scripture to God with us in prayer. Father, we come before you, and with these words fresh upon our hearts, we can and we must confess that I believe, God, each and every one of us has committed this sin of partiality at some point in our lives. And we're probably tempted to it more than we even recognize, God. Tempted to honor the wealthy over the poor. Tempted to honor those who have power and can give something to us in return versus those who can offer nothing. But Father, your word calls that plainly sin, and we must repent. We must turn from our sin. We must look to Jesus Christ and his completed work at Calvary for the forgiveness and cleansing of that sin. And God, we must look to you and your Spirit to work in us that we might walk in this sin no longer. That instead of showing that kind of partiality that is harsh with one person and lenient with another, that kind of sinful judgment that does not honor you, God, that we might have the right judgment of Jesus Christ in our hearts and minds. That we might judge every single man, woman, and child as created in the image of God and inherently valuable and worth our time and love and attention. Our Savior Jesus came and walked among those who were of the humblest birth and estate. Those who had little to offer, those who were the outcast of society because of their sin, because of their life choices, because of all kinds of things, and yet he walked among them and loved them. He proclaimed the good news of the kingdom of God to those who were rich and those who were poor. And Father, our prayer is that you would make us a people who do exactly the same. There are those of great esteem, great power, great wealth in our community who desperately need nothing more than to hear that Jesus Christ will cleanse them from their sins and make them new. And there are those, God, in our community who have nothing, no power, no means, no societal significance, and yet, God, they are significant to you. And they must be significant to us. They too, God, more than they need physical provision, need to hear that the gospel of the kingdom means they can have eternal life in Jesus Christ and full provision for their greatest need. So God, would you work in our hearts? Would you root out from us partiality, and would you cause us to be loving and compassionate and tender and proclaim the gospel to all men and all women and all children, regardless of where they come from? Father, would you teach us by your word this morning? We're going to turn and look again in Hebrews 12 at an unpopular topic, a hard topic, and yet, God, something you've put in your word for our good. So would you shape and form the hearts and minds of your people this morning? Would you give us ears to hear and eyes to see and hearts ready to believe your word that what is laid out for us is for our good? Would you give us hands and feet willing to be the body of Christ as we've just sung? Would you give us a willingness to expend ourselves for the good of our brothers and sisters? Show us Jesus Christ through the preaching of the word, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I want you to turn with me over to Hebrews chapter 12. And I'm going to do something today that I'm not sure I've ever done before as pastor of Redeemer Community Church. We looked last week at Hebrews chapter 12, verses 3 through 13, and I preached a sermon I entitled Healing Discipline. And today we're going to look again at Hebrews chapter 12, verses 3 through 13, and I want to preach to you this morning about helping discipline. You remember, if you were with us last week, that we talked about this discipline that God brings into our lives, and the main point that we were trying to understand from this text is that the discipline of the Lord is for our good. God doesn't discipline us to be harsh with us or to make us feel bad. God disciplines us to nurture us and grow us and mold us and shape us and ultimately to fit us for His kingdom. We talked about how the discipline of God produces, remember what it says, that peaceable fruit of righteousness in our lives. And as we went through the text, we talked about how we see this discipline of the Lord in all of the various circumstances of our life, right? In the trials we face and in the tribulations and difficulties. Because remember, we said that discipline in this sense is not just talking about punitive discipline, right? It's that instruction, it's that training ground, that teaching ground of the Lord where He builds us up to be who He has called us to be. And as we talked about this discipline in the circumstances and situations of life, I came away with the idea that there's a temptation we might leave that in the very abstract realm, right? I told you that if you have the right mindset, you can see every difficulty in life as the discipline of the Lord, right? An opportunity for God to teach you and train you and grow you up. But that still feels kind of out there, right? It feels largely open to interpretation. And remember I said, people have this question, is this thing the discipline of the Lord in my life? Well, the reality is there's another way that God brings discipline into our lives. It's not only through the trials and the afflictions and the hardships of life, although that is largely a part of it, but He also brings discipline in our lives through a community of brothers and sisters in Christ, believers, disciples of Jesus Christ, covenanted together. God brings discipline to His church. It's called church discipline. It's a scary term for some folks, right? It's something you may not have listened to 100 sermons on, right? There's lots of sermons about, you know, Daniel and the lion's den. There's lots of sermons about Job, and there's lots of sermons about Abraham, but there's not a lot of sermons out there about church discipline. The reality is that church discipline has gotten a pretty bad rap, right? It's a scary thing, and certainly, let's just go ahead and say it from the outset, this doctrine clearly taught in scriptures has been abused in many places and used wrongly. But in an increasingly individualistic world that we live in, where self has been elevated to the status of God, right? And what is right is what I feel, and how dare anyone challenge me, this idea of discipline among a community of believers is incredibly unpopular. In fact, you can just go Google church discipline if you want to, and you know what you're going to find? You're going to find website after website after website of people explaining how crazy these fanatical Christians are because they hold people to a standard of biblical faithfulness via church discipline. Practicing church discipline according to biblical standards is probably one of the fastest ways in today's time to get branded as some kind of fundamentalist fanatic. It just is. And that's probably the reason why the vast majority, I think it's safe to say, of churches either A, don't know anything about this topic, or B, definitely don't practice it biblically. And yet, it's here and it's for our good. You see, the model of church discipline displayed to us in Hebrews chapter 12, the loving discipline of God our Father, is the model to be followed by the church. Our discipline towards one another is to be demonstrated in love. So I want to read just a portion of this text this morning that we read last week. And then what we're going to do is take a biblical survey this morning of passages that talk about church discipline. So have your Bible ready, or maybe just your notepad, and scratch these down as we go through. I don't know. We're going to cover a dozen or 15 different passages this morning. But in Hebrews 12, I want to begin in verse 3 reading. Says this, consider him who endured from sinners such hostility against himself so that you may not grow weary or faint-hearted. In your struggle against sin, you've not yet resisted to the point of shedding your blood. And have you forgotten the exhortation that addresses you as sons? My son, do not regard lightly the discipline of the Lord, nor be weary when reproved by him. For the Lord disciplines the one he loves and chastises every son whom he receives. It is for discipline that you have to endure. God is treating you as sons, for what son is there whom his father does not discipline? If you're left without discipline in which all have participated, then you are illegitimate children and not sons. Besides this, we've had earthly fathers who disciplined us and we respected them. Shall we not much more be subject to the Father of spirits and live? For they disciplined us for a short time as it seemed best to them, but he disciplines us for our good, that we may share his holiness. And finally this, for the moment, all discipline seems painful rather than pleasant, but later it yields the peaceful fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained by it. So first I want to start by looking at this text and other biblical texts and building the foundations for church discipline. What is it that we build this doctrine, this truth upon, this practice of church discipline? I've already said it this morning, right? The loving discipline of God our Father is the model for every practice of discipline within the church. Every single time. If it is not conducted according to the loving discipline of God our Father, then it's being done wrongly. You saw what he said in verse 6, right? When he quoted it out of Proverbs, the Lord disciplines the one he loves and chastises every son whom he receives. The church must be motivated by the same love that God has demonstrated towards us. A kind of love that will not leave us trapped and tangled in our sin, even if there's a great personal cost in dealing with it. Because make no mistake, from the outset, I want you to know this. To practice church discipline lovingly with one another will cost you greatly. It will cost you your time. It might cost you, temporarily at least, a friendship, a relationship. There may be hardships. It will cost you energy that you don't feel like you have to give. It will cost you your personal freedom, that individuality we have where we get to come to church on Sunday morning and then go home and we get to live our own lives privately in a bubble until the next Sunday. It will break apart all of those things, but it's motivated by the love of God for others. You remember the illustration he used in this text last week? It's about parents disciplining their children, right? And we talked briefly about how failing to discipline a child is failing to love them well, right? If you're unwilling, either because of laziness or fear or whatever, if you're unwilling to lovingly discipline your children, you're not loving them. You're loving yourself over them. And the truth is the same. If we are unwilling to practice what God has called us to in His Word, then it's the same thing. We love ourselves more than we love our brothers and sisters. Perhaps we love the ease of relationship when we don't get into anything too serious, right? It's easier to talk about the weather and the latest sports game and what's going on at your job than it is to really dig in with somebody and find out where they're struggling and encourage them and hold them accountable. But it's critical, and here's why. The aim of church discipline, the reason that we participate in this process and do this with one another, is nothing less than the very salvation of souls. You understand how Hebrews has been warning us time and again what happens if we allow sin to just kind of fester and grow in our lives, and how eventually over time we find ourselves farther and farther and farther away from God until there's a possibility we demonstrate that our faith was never really genuine. The discipline of the Lord is designed to push us back to the gospel of Jesus Christ, to charge us again and again with trusting in Him for our salvation. 1 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 5 says it this way. In one of the cases of discipline recorded for us in the New Testament that is perhaps most helpful, Paul says this really bold thing. He's talking about this man who'd sinned greatly. He says, "You are to deliver this man to Satan for the destruction of the flesh so that his spirit may be saved in the day of the Lord." Whoa, Paul. Don't be such a fanatic, right? You hear what he's saying? Turn this person over who sinned so greatly to Satan that their flesh may be destroyed. Why? In hopes that their soul might be saved. Because Paul believed Jesus when Jesus said, it's better for you to enter into heaven maimed than with both your hands. It's better for you to come with one eye or no eyes than to lose your soul. What can it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his soul? The most valuable thing you can have in this life is a right relationship with God and that inheritance of eternal life. And in order to protect and preserve that, we have to engage with the sin in our lives and continually fight against it. That's why Paul says, turn this man over that his flesh might be destroyed. And we go, oh no, that doesn't sound very nice, Paul. And Paul says, I don't want to be nice to the guy if he ends up in hell forever. What good is niceness? This doctrine of niceness has crept into the church where we think that showing love and grace to people means that we talk to them softly and don't actually say what we need to say. We don't really call them to account for their sins. Nothing could be more unkind than leaving someone deceived in sin. Now understand this also, church discipline is not some kind of authoritarian power trip. Right? The idea is not that we have this tremendous power invested in us by God and we get to exercise it, right? I'm just walking through the church every Sunday morning watching you guys going, who can I catch today? Right? We're going to get somebody. They messed up. Got my whip coiled up in my back pocket, just ready. Whoosh. How dare you sin that way? It's not that, is it? It's not authoritarian. It's not a power trip. Galatians chapter 6, verse 1 says this, brothers, if anyone is caught in any transgression, you who are spiritual should restore him, listen to this, in a spirit of gentleness. And hear this warning, keep watch on yourself, lest you too be tempted. You understand that if you approach church discipline with the wrong attitude and the wrong heart, you are setting yourself up for failure. You could fall into perhaps the very same sin or a more egregious sin. If you can't imitate the gentle spirit of our Savior in approaching a brother or sister in Christ, you're setting yourself up for disaster. So it's not this power trip. It's actually sacrificing of yourself for the good of someone else. And then finally, as we talk about foundations of church discipline, I want you to understand this. Church discipline is built upon a legitimate relationship to the body of Jesus Christ. You remember we read in verse 8 last week, if you're left without discipline in which all have participated, then you are illegitimate children and not sons. And we talked about how the discipline of God is one of those validating ideas in our life that shows us we truly belong to Him because He disciplines every child whom He loves. And it's the same with the church. The discipline of the church practiced together is a validation of the relationship we have that we are covenanted together as one body. Church discipline is not to be practiced by us as the family of Redeemer Community Church on any Christian anywhere in the world, right? I see some pastor on the other side of the world and he posts something on Twitter that, you know, I'm not going to start the process of church discipline with that brother. God has placed him in his sovereignty and in relationship and covenant community with another church body somewhere else. Church discipline is to be practiced by those who are rightly connected to the covenant community of a local church. In the same way the providential discipline of God legitimizes the son and daughter relationship we have to God, the normal biblical practice of church discipline legitimizes the relationship that we share with one another as the covenant community of Christ. And that's why we can't talk about church discipline without talking about church membership. In fact, you guys know there's not a verse in the Bible that says, thou shalt join a local church. You understand that? The clearest case we have for church membership in the Bible, the most expansive case is actually church discipline. Because apart from meaningful membership showing that you belong to a covenant community, how can the body of Christ and the elders of a church truly practice this church discipline? Let me explain to you what I mean a little bit. In 1 Corinthians 5, we're going to go there in a few minutes and look at some more of the details, but he uses this belonging language repeatedly to show that they belong to something. He says, there's sin among you. He says, remove this one from among you when you are assembled. He talks about how leaven affects the whole lump. In other words, he's describing them as one body, and the leaven that has come into it is going to affect everyone. He talks about not associating with the one in sin. He says most clearly this, is it not those inside the church whom you are to judge? God judges those outside. Purge the evil person from among you. And my question to you would be this, how can you purge someone from among you who doesn't formally and rightly belong to you, right? If you're not a member of the body, then God forbid you persist in sin and the church needs to put you out of the body. We can't really do that. So church discipline is founded upon the loving discipline of God our Father and upon the legitimate relationship to the body that we should share. Now let's talk about the types of church discipline. Let me pull back for a minute. If you're feeling like I just jumped out of the gate and this has all been fire hose, let's slow down for a minute and think about how this actually works out in the body. It's not all scary. In fact, much of it is hugely beneficial and for our good. There's two types of church discipline that the church has historically understood. There's formative discipline and there's corrective discipline. Now, the part we've heard all the terrible things about and that people are generally scared of is corrective discipline. But first, let's talk about formative discipline. That's the everyday, ordinary discipline of the church that should happen most of the time. In fact, when we talk about church discipline, really what we're talking about 98.9% of the time is this formative discipline of the church. It's actually happening right now. As I preach to you and proclaim the Word of God, your thoughts and understanding of God's Word and God's world are being shaped and molded. That is a discipline process. You're being discipled. You know, discipline and disciple, they share the same root. So your understanding of God's Word is being shaped not only by the preacher on Sunday morning, but by the community of believers around you. This happens week after week and day after day as we teach and instruct one another in the truth of God's Word and we encourage one another towards godly living. This doesn't just happen on Sunday morning when you hear the Word preached. It happens on Tuesday afternoon when maybe you sit down in someone's house and linger over a cup of coffee or tea and talk about the things that are facing you and they encourage you with a scripture. It happens on a Friday evening when maybe your family gathers with another family around the dinner table and you guys talk about what's going on in your world and they say, you know, we went through this same situation and here's what God taught us in that. Let me just share this with you from experience. It happens when husbands and wives lovingly point one another to Christ in the midst of everyday life and struggles, right? This is all the formative discipline of the church. This is what the writer to Hebrews was talking about just a couple of chapters back in chapter 10, verse 24 and 25. Remember what he said? Let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another and all the more as you see the day drawing near. That's what he's talking about. Formative discipline, building one another up. This is what God has called us to as a body of believers. We read about it over in Ephesians chapter 4, right? You guys are familiar with this passage of Scripture. He's talking about how he's given the apostles and the prophets and the evangelists and the shepherd teachers to the church. And then he says in chapter 4, verse 15, speaking the truth in love, we are to grow up in every way to him who is the head, into Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and held together by every joint with which it is equipped, when each part is working properly, makes the body grow so that it builds itself up in love. What does that sound like? It sounds like you and me and the entire covenant family of Redeemer Community Church and every other local church in the world that's faithful, shaping and strengthening and molding one another so that we grow up in the faith. So that what he talked about back in Hebrews chapter 6 doesn't happen, right? When he said, hey, I want to talk to you about this really complicated Melchizedek thing, but you've got a growth defect. You haven't grown up. You're still children. You need me to teach you the elementary principles again. Why did that happen? Because the formative discipline of the church was not happening. The more faithfully we pursue formative discipline, generally speaking, the less often we must pursue corrective discipline. This seems to me to make a lot of sense. If we are faithful in studying the Word, knowing the Word, meditating upon the Word, speaking the Word to one another and encouraging one another with the Word, guess what? Sin won't reign so clearly and presently amongst our body, will it? It's amazing. It's as if God has ordained the means of grace, the Word of God, in our life to root out sin. So that we don't have to have all those really hard conversations where we go, hey, brother, I just want to share with you, I saw this thing going on, and that's sin. And they go, what? Really? Well, yeah, it's right here in Colossians chapter 2. I never read that before. That's why Jesus said, have you not read? Right? Sometimes as a pastor, have you not read? It's right there. But we have to build one another up and encourage one another with the Word of God. That's why Paul encourages in Colossians chapter 3, verse 16, this verse you also know, right? Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness in your hearts to God. Is he just telling us how good, quiet church mouse people live their lives? With a lot of scripture and a lot of songs in their heart? No, he's describing to us how the formative discipline of God works in the body of Christ. We each bear an individual and a corporate responsibility. Do you understand that when you do not faithfully consume God's word, you're not only harming yourself, you're actually harming the entire community, the covenant community of God's people? No man is an island unto himself, and certainly not in the redeemed people of God. You are saved into a family. And you owe it not only to God and faithfulness and to yourself for your own spiritual growth, but to your brothers and sisters in Christ to be building up in the Word day after day so that you have something to share, something to encourage. If you've been a Christian for one day, you have something to share with others. If you've been a Christian for 10 years, you better have something to share with others. If you've been a Christian for 30, 40, 50 years, then the Word of God should have taken root in your life in such a way that you can be those older men and older women that Paul describes elsewhere who can teach and disciple and admonish those who are younger than him, help them grow up. That's the formative discipline of the church. And honestly, when we talk about church discipline, it's not just as if we lack that corrective aspect. That's the part people talk about most. We suffer greatly for a lack of formative discipline. So God wants to build us up and grow us through that. The other type of discipline is corrective, and that type of discipline deals with a specific sin that a fellow believer, a brother or sister in Christ, is committing. And the aim of corrective discipline is to lovingly correct a brother or sister who is blinded by deception and help them see their sin rightly so that they may turn from it. Corrective discipline is restorative. You hear me? Corrective discipline is restorative. It is not punitive in nature. The idea is not that we'll punish this person. The idea is that we will win them back. That they may have grown entangled in some sin that for whatever reason in their life they can't see. And we might help shine the light of the gospel of Jesus Christ and the Word of God into that area of life, and that the Spirit will help them see it, and that they will repent of that sin and be restored to fellowship in the body of Christ. It has to be that way. If it's anything less than that, it's not church discipline, whatever it is. It might be some sort of legalistic, fundamentalistic, just aim to whip conformity out of a group of people so that they all fit in. But if it is not loving, doesn't have the aim of restoration, it's not church discipline. That brings us to another important question. If we're going to confront one another in sin, we have to ask the obvious question, right? About which sins are we going to confront one another? How many times do you sin a day? You guys want to take a poll? Everybody want to share their answer? Come stand in front of the camera in the live stream and tell everybody. How many times do you sin in the course of a day? 5? 50? 500? I don't know. Here's how I've always put this in perspective for myself. The Word tells us that we should love the Lord our God with all our heart, mind, soul, and strength. And if you just judge me on that one, about how often in the course of a day I'm doing that to 100% of my capacity, I can assure you that I persist in sin quite often. God forgive me. And the grace of Jesus Christ covers that, and He continues to grow me and shape me. But the reality is, we all sin, in a sense, a whole awful lot, don't we? So if we went around every day, every single time we saw our brother or sister commit any sin, no matter how great or small in our eyes, we would be quite a busy bunch of folks, wouldn't we? We'd all have to quit our jobs. right? That's just going to multiply the amount of sin you have. You know, when you show up to work on Monday morning with a bad attitude and start yelling at people. And we just have to be in everybody's stuff all day long. It doesn't sound very fun or joyful, does it? God intends this discipline to be for our good and for our joy, honestly. So you remember that passage where Jesus talked about in Matthew chapter 7 about judging other people and confronting them? I think that's instructive to this thought. He said, think about this for a minute. Are you going to go to your brother who's got a little speck of sawdust in his eye and say, hey, let me get that out for you. Meanwhile, there's a 2x6 sticking out of your eye socket. Just imagine, right? Just imagine you go to the emergency room today because you get something in your eye. And the doctor walks in and they introduce themselves and say, hey, I'm Dr. So-and-so. And meanwhile, you notice there's like a giant log sticking out of their eye socket. And you go, hey, doc, nice to meet you. Perhaps there's somebody else here who could attend to this for me, right? The point Jesus is making is that we should examine our own hearts first, right? Before we go judging the sin in other people's hearts, we have to examine ourselves rightly first. Now, that's the same place where everybody loves to quote Jesus as saying, judge not lest you be judged, right? For what it's worth, that's the same Jesus who says, judge with righteous judgment. It's not as if we're not supposed to judge. We're supposed to judge with righteous, non-hypocritical, non-self-righteous judgment, according to the Word of God, not our preferences, and we're supposed to do so in a spirit of gentleness. A couple of other verses that seem to speak to this. Proverbs chapter 19, verse 11 says this, good sense makes one slow to anger, and it is his glory to overlook an offense. Brothers and sisters, I want to tell you right now, there are many, 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 many sins and offenses that are going to happen between brothers and sisters in Christ that we should gloriously overlook. We should just say, you know what? Yeah, I'm weak in that same way. Doesn't mean you shouldn't encourage a brother or sister. Help them as you see fit, as you have opportunity. Hey, you know, I struggle with this sin too in my life. Let me tell you some things that are helpful to me. But you probably shouldn't be swinging the hammer over every little thing that comes your way. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 8 says this, love covers a multitude of sins. If we have genuine love for one another, the kind that Jesus prayed in John 17 we would have that's a testimony to the watching world, if we have that genuine love for one another, there's a lot of things that are not going to rise to the level of causing us to confront one another in sin. You might pray for someone. You might share a word of scripture and encouragement, but there are a lot of things that go. There's not a hard and fast rule, okay? I'm sorry to disappoint you guys. There's not a list in the Bible that says, for these sins you shall confront and these sins you shall not. It's not in there. You have to exercise wisdom in the Spirit of God. You've got to begin with that process of searching your own heart. If you are going to a brother or sister in Christ to confront them about their sin from a place of anger, from a place of self-righteousness, from a place of really hoping to give them a piece of your mind and put them in their place, you don't need to confront that sin. You need to deal with your own heart. But there are times where you may deal with your own heart and then still go to a brother or sister. It happens. So it takes a lot of biblical wisdom. This is another one of those reasons we need to be steeped in the Word of God to be able to understand and discern when we need to confront a brother or sister and when we don't. Let's talk about the process of discipline, right? This is where we go to Matthew 18, right? If you've had any knowledge of church discipline, it's probably been based out of Matthew 18, verses 15 through 20. Here's what it says. If your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault between you and him alone. If he listens to you, you've gained your brother. But if he does not listen, take one or two others along with you, that every charge may be established by the evidence of two or three witnesses. If he refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if he refuses to listen even to the church, let him be to you as a Gentile and a tax collector. Truly I say to you, whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Again I say to you, if two of you agree on earth about anything they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am among them. Did you know that was the context of that verse of Scripture? It's about church discipline. When two or three gather, humbling themselves before God and by the power of His Holy Spirit to confront and encourage a brother or sister in their sin, God promises to be there with them, amongst them in that. So there's a process of discipline that has to happen, and it moves from an informal process of corrective discipline towards a more formal process of corrective discipline. First, it begins informally, right? It's a private, one-on-one confrontation of a brother or a sister in sin. And the good news is this, the vast majority of the time, this is all it takes to deal with sin amongst us in the church. The overwhelming majority of the time, if we would humble ourselves and approach our brothers and sisters with a spirit of gentleness and confront them in their sin, we would win them. Because think about it. You've all harbored sin in your life before, haven't you? Yeah. And there's a time where through some circumstances or through a brother or sister confronting you, that sin that you thought was hidden came to the light. You know what typically happens with sins brought into the light? What the Bible says will happen to them. They're destroyed by the light of the gospel of Jesus Christ. They're put to death. Sometimes we need eyes to see and we don't have them. So God has put us in a community of people who can notice those blind spots around us and those entangling, encumbering sins that have gotten a hold of us and gotten root in our lives. And God sends a brother or sister along to free us from those things. That's all it takes. It sounds scary, but it's really not. It's the wonder of God's overwhelming grace to us that He's given us a spirit. You realize when you go to speak to a brother or sister who's in sin, you're going with this one glorious reality. Assuming that you're a Christian and they're a Christian, you're both meeting together and you both have the Spirit of God within you. The Spirit of God who convicts us. The Spirit of God who urges us to repentance. The Spirit of God that urges us to glorify Christ. So you're not going alone even when you go by yourself. Now, what happens when that doesn't work? He tells us, if you go to them and you confront them in their sin and they're obstinate and they say, I don't think that's a sin, or I think that's a sin, but I'm not going to repent, or any other thing than, yeah, I repent, thank you, let's move forward in this together. Then he calls us to take along a couple of other people with us. He says, take one or two witnesses. Why? So that your case can be stronger? Well, in a sense, yes. But also, so that the accusation you are bringing against them can be confirmed by two or three witnesses. Because is there anybody here who is tempted at times to make things biblical commands that aren't actually there? Yes, this happens to us often, doesn't it? We're tempted to promote our traditions and our historical interpretations to the position of God has said, when in fact God has not said. And so even in this pursuit, he brings others around us to confirm the situation that this is in fact a sin and it wasn't just some sort of misunderstanding. You saw something, you thought it was this, but you didn't see the whole story. Or maybe you're trying to confront this brother or sister for something that's actually not sin. It's just a matter of preference or adiaphora. So he says, bring along a couple of others. And as the pursuit of this one in sin stalls out, the process moves away from something being informal towards a more formal situation. So when it involves one or two others and then eventually the entire church, somewhere around that second step or certainly before the third step happens, the elders of the church are to be involved in this process. I want to share that with you. We're a church that believes in elder leadership. We believe it's taught in the scriptures, and we believe that God has put qualified, called men into place to oversee the affairs of the church, and nowhere is that more important than as church discipline begins to move towards those later stages. So one of the one or two others may be an elder or may not need to be. It doesn't have to be in every case. But there's a reality that's going to head in towards a more formal situation, because if it is necessary for the sin of a member of the body to be brought before the church, that is the responsibility of the elders to do. Now, when people teach on Matthew 18, sometimes they tend to forget that there are other passages of Scripture that talk about church discipline. So I want to just give you a real quick overview of some other places, and you understand that the process doesn't always look this neat and clean. You notice one real distinct thing that it doesn't tell us in Matthew 18? How long goes between the first step and the second step? How long goes between the second step and the third step? Anybody? It's not in there. I've looked cover to cover. There's not a date or a time period or a period of days or weeks or months or years. It's wisdom. So there are exceptions. In Titus chapter 3, verses 10 and 11, we read this. As for a person who stirs up division after warning him once and then twice, have nothing more to do with him, knowing that such a person is warped and sinful. He is self-condemned. Now again, that doesn't include time frames, but it seems like he's speaking of a much quicker and more decisive action against a person who's sowing discord and division among the body of Christ. Warn him once, warn him twice, have nothing more to do with him. That's the same language he uses later when he says, put them out of the church, don't even eat with them, don't associate with them. It's excommunication is what he's referring to. Cutting them off from the table of the Lord and declaring as the body of Christ that although we can't truly see someone's heart, we see no evidence in their life that they are truly a follower of Jesus. In 1 Corinthians chapter 5, we'll look at this for a minute now. I mentioned it a couple of times already. It says this beginning in verse 1. It is actually reported that there is sexual immorality among you and of a kind that's not tolerated even among pagans. For a man has his father's wife and you are arrogant. Ought you not to rather mourn? Let him who has done this be removed from among you. For though absent in body, I'm present in spirit. And as if present, I have already pronounced judgment on the one who did such a thing. When you are assembled in the name of the Lord Jesus and my spirit is present with the power of our Lord Jesus, you are to deliver this man to Satan for the destruction of the flesh so his spirit may be saved on the day of the Lord. What is he saying? He's saying, don't wait for me to get there. There's not time for that. This sin is of such an egregious and serious nature that the very next time the church gathers together, you need to put this man out of the body. Why? Because Paul's so disgusted with his sin, he thinks there's no hope for him? No, remember what he said? Remember where we started? The hope is that putting him out in such a bold and decisive way and turning him over for the destruction of his flesh would lead to the salvation of his soul. Paul says, we've got to love this man enough not to even play around with this thing. One more place where the process may be slightly altered is in 1 Timothy chapter 5, verses 19 and 20. It deals with the sin of elders. It says, do not admit a charge against an elder except on the evidence of two or three witnesses. As for those who persist in sin, rebuke them in the presence of all so that the rest may stand in fear. And a lot of people read this and they think, oh, the elders, they get a pass, right? You got to have two or three witnesses to even admit a charge against them. You also have to rebuke them in front of everyone so that everyone else may shake with fear. That's the reality. When he says don't admit a charge, he doesn't mean that you can't come and talk to an elder if you think they're in sin. What he means is that we should not receive that charge except on the evidence of two or three witnesses. That was the Old Testament standard of justice, period, wasn't it? Two or three witnesses to confirm everything. Elders do not get a pass from church discipline. In fact, elders are held to a higher account, and they're to be rebuked publicly when they sin. There's sadly a lack of this in churches also. No man is above the discipline of God, and no man is above the discipline of a faithful Bible-believing church. So that's the process of church discipline. We've talked about the foundations of it, right? It's built in the love of God and the covenant community. We've talked about the process and some of the ways that works out. I want to settle down with this. Four aims of church discipline. What is this aimed at? Is it just to create some kind of contentious environment where we're always getting at each other's throats about how terrible we are? Is it a new way to make us feel bad about ourselves? Four aims that I see pretty clearly in Scripture. First, church discipline is for the good of sinners. And I don't mean those sinners out there. I mean we sinners right here. It's for the good of the person who is pursued in church discipline because they're warned of the very real danger of sin and hopefully rescued from their sin. Hebrews has told us time and again about the danger of drifting, of not being awake and alert and paying attention and striving towards holiness. James chapter 5, verses 19 and 20. My brothers, if anyone among you wanders from the truth and someone brings him back, let him know that whoever brings back a sinner from his wandering will save his soul from death and will cover a multitude of sins. It's not about just making us a nice group of people who don't do the bad things that we're not supposed to do. It's about keeping us eyes focused on the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's for the good of sinners. Next, it's for the good of the church. It's for the good of the whole covenant community, the church. The church is reminded about the seriousness of sin and put on watch to guard their own hearts and made serious and sober. How often are we not that serious about sin? Let's be honest. Right? There's some of the big ones that we're scared of. We don't ever want to do those. But how many sins have we grown comfortable with? And we're perfectly fine with them existing among large portions of the body, and it's just okay. We're not going to talk about them, right? The church is purified through the process of church discipline because you know why? The bride of Christ is to be pure, holy. Jesus gave his life for us to cleanse us from sin. Why would we play games with it? Paul writes in 2 Corinthians chapter 7, after he's written 1 Corinthians and really been strong against the church at Corinth, in chapter 7, verse 9 of 2 Corinthians, he says this, "As it is, I rejoice, not because you were grieved, but because you were grieved into repenting. For you felt a godly grief, so that you suffered no loss through us. For godly grief produces a repentance that leads to salvation without regret, whereas worldly grief produces death. For see what earnestness this godly grief has produced in you, but also what eagerness to clear yourselves, what indignation, what fear, what longing, what zeal, what punishment. At every point you have proved yourselves innocent in the matter." What's he saying? He's saying, I wrote to you and boldly confronted sin in the church and you were grieved by it, but it was for your good because it was godly grief that led to repentance. There's a whole other lesson in 2 Corinthians 7, 9 through 11 about what genuine repentance looks like. I would encourage you to mark that down and read it later. When he talks about eagerness to clear ourselves, indignation, fear, longing, zeal, punishment, all those things are the marks of godly grief and true repentance. So it's for the good of sinners. It's for the good of the church. It's for our gospel witness. It's for our gospel witness because there's nothing more defeating to the testimony of a church that says Jesus Christ can save you from your sins than a bunch of people saying it who are stuck in their sins. That's a self-defeating argument, right? If we just wallow and let sin reign amongst us and we go tell the world, good news, Jesus will forgive you from your sins and make you new and you ain't no newer than you were before. Church discipline is vital to our gospel witness. And as a side note, you know one of the best ways for us to get about this? It's actually as we're pursuing the mission of the church, making disciples, that these sins and struggles and sinful attitudes will come to the surface and we can deal with them amongst each other. So church discipline is so integrally tied to the mission of the church, it can't be separated. If all we do is come together on Sunday morning and sit and listen to sermons, then we go home and we don't live any life together, we don't pursue any making of disciples together, we don't minister to our community together, we'll never know the sins that one another are dealing with and we'll never deal with them together. It's actually when we get on mission that these things bubble to the top and we can deal with them. 1 Corinthians 5, after that first part we read, he says in 6 and 7, "Your boasting is not good. Do you not know that a little leaven leavens the whole lump? Cleanse out the old leaven that you may be a new lump as you really are unleavened." What is he saying? He's saying that sin that you let persist among the body of Christ, it's destroying your witness to the whole world. It might not be your sin particularly, but you belong to a covenant community of believers. If we ignore it and overlook it, our words ring hollow when we share the gospel. Finally, and most importantly, the fourth aim of church discipline is this. It is for the glory of Jesus Christ. It is nothing less than designed to honor and exalt the glory of Jesus Christ. Because our aim as the body of Christ, the reason that we exist here on earth today, is to bring glory and honor to the name of Jesus Christ and to make disciples, right? That's it. It's to exalt Christ. And if we don't deal with sin in our midst, we're not exalting Christ, we're exalting ourselves at the expense of Christ. He goes on in 1 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 9. He says, "I wrote to you in my letter not to associate with sexually immoral people." Not at all meaning the sexually immoral of this world or the greedy and swindlers or idolaters, since then you would need to go out of the world. He says, I'm not talking about the out there people, but now I'm writing you to not associate with anyone who bears the name of brother if he is guilty of sexual immorality or greed or is an idolater, reviler, drunkard, or swindler, not even to eat with such a one. For what have I to do with judging outsiders? Is it not those inside the church whom you are to judge? God judges those outside. Purge the evil person from among you. He's telling us that the glory of Christ is at stake in the practice of loving, faithful, biblical church discipline. And the question is, how valuable is the glory of Christ? How important is it that we promote a true image of who God is to the world around us? Because when we don't deal with sin, we lie to the world about who God is and what He can do in our lives. We say God can make you okay, but He can't truly deal with your sin. How far should we go to pursue the glory of Christ? Is it worth the loving, patient, enduring pursuit of rooting out sin in our lives together? Absolutely. Absolutely it's worth that. Christ is worthy, and thus we must pursue this together as the body, in a spirit of love and in gentleness with one another, seeking the good of each other and the body through faithful church discipline. Let's pray. Father, Your word tells us that Your discipline is for our good. It's because You love us. It produces in us a peaceful fruit of righteousness. And I pray that You would teach us, particularly as a local congregation, as the body of Christ at Redeemer Community Church, You would teach us how to faithfully, patiently, gently, and lovingly pursue this together. Not in a way that crushes those who are caught in sin, but God, in a way that strengthens and restores. In a way that deals seriously with sin, but believes seriously in the good news of Jesus. So help us, Father, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, we get to do something we haven't done together in a while. And we're going to do it from 1 Corinthians chapter 11. Before coronavirus and before all of the restrictions that came in place, it was the practice of Redeemer Community Church every week to come before the table of the Lord together and to proclaim together that we are hoping alone in the life and death of Jesus Christ and His resurrection, and that He is our only hope in this life and the life to come. Every time we take the bread and drink the cup, we are proclaiming the Lord's death until He returns. You know what that means? Not only that we're trusting in what He's done, but we're trusting that He's going to return for us. And it was such a sweet part of our service each week that it was devastating as we have not been able to do that. So I'm grateful. So if you didn't get elements this morning, I know this is a little different than what we're used to. So we'll bear through this together. But they're in a basket back there at the back if you don't have one. We're a church that believes that the Lord's table is open to every believer in the Lord Jesus Christ who's trusting in Christ alone for salvation. And so if you're with us this morning, whether you're a member or a visitor, if you have trusted in Christ alone for salvation, you are welcome to the table with us to celebrate. If you're here this morning and you're not yet a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ, then I'm going to encourage you, and I'm going to do this from Scripture in just a moment, not to partake of these elements. It's okay if you walked in this morning and grabbed one of these. You can leave it aside, take it home with you. It would not be to your benefit to eat and drink of the bread and the cup without rightly understanding what Christ has come to accomplish. Let's look at that quickly from 1 Corinthians chapter 11, beginning in verse 23. For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when He was betrayed, took bread. And when He had given thanks, He broke it and said, "This is My body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of Me." In the same way also He took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in My blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of Me. For often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until He comes." And then He warns us, "Whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and blood of the Lord. Let a person examine himself then, and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment on himself. That is why many of you are weak and ill, and some have died. But if we judged ourselves truly, we would not be judged. But when we are judged by the Lord, we are disciplined so that we may not be condemned along with the world." He covers it all in just a few verses, doesn't he? The good news is this: if you're with us this morning and you are not a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ, God has made a way through Jesus' life, death, and resurrection to cleanse you from your sins, to free you from all unrighteousness, and to welcome you into His family. You can be saved from your sin and given new life, eternal life in Jesus Christ today by turning from your sin and trusting in Him. If you want to know more about what that means, I'd be happy to talk with you after our service and explain more and encourage you and pray with you in that respect. For those of us who are believers, though, he calls us when we come to the table to examine ourselves, examine our hearts. Why? To see if we're perfect? Certainly not, right? None of us are perfect. To see if we are truly trusting in Christ alone for our salvation. Because if we are, what will we be doing? Rightly and honestly dealing with the sin that persists in our lives. Calling upon God and His grace to forgive us and transform us. Judging ourselves rightly and encouraging one another in the discipline of the Lord. You see, it was right here in the text, church discipline, as we talk about the body of Christ. So search your heart this morning. Ask God to reveal to you if you are hiding sin from Him and from your brothers and sisters in the body. And if you have need to go and be reconciled with someone, if you have need to deal with sin in your life today, then I would encourage you along with the Scriptures, don't take of this meal this morning. Instead, you should make a beeline to resolve that when we're done. But if you come today having trusted in Christ alone, then I want to invite you. Open the bread, and we'll take this out. And I'm going to pray and give thanks for the bread. Father, we thank you for the body of Christ that was broken for us. We thank you, God, that Jesus did not consider equality with God a thing to be grasped at, but he humbled himself, taking on flesh, that he humbled himself to the point of death, even death upon a cross, so that the penalty I deserve and the penalty these deserve for our sins was placed upon him. We thank you, God, that as we remember his broken body, we know that we deserved those stripes. We deserved that judgment, and yet now we have new life in Christ. Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. Church, Christ's body was broken for you. Eat and remember. And now let's pray and give thanks for the cup. Father, for the precious blood of Jesus Christ that was poured out to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. For that fountain drawn from Emmanuel's vein that cleanses us as we are plunged beneath it. For the ever-powerful blood of Jesus Christ that has washed us from all our sins and not just some of our sins, we give you thanks. It is by this blood that we have become the redeemed people of God. Praise you, O God, for what you've done. In Jesus' name, amen. Church, Christ's blood was poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Drink and remember. Amen. Mark's going to come forward. We're going to stand and sing a song of response together.
Well, let's please stand together. I want to apologize for the guitar thing. I think it's probably a battery of, there's a couple of different ones it could be, and so there's not really time to hunt all that down, so just go a little old school here, and it'll be a good reason to sing out. So we're going to close out by singing All the People Said Amen.
You were not alone. If you are lonely when you feel afraid, you're not the only. We are all the same in need of mercy to be forgiven and be free. It's all you've got to lean on, but thank God it's all you need. And all the people said amen. Oh, and all the people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord, for his love never ends. And all the people said amen. Well, if you're rich or poor, well, it don't matter. Weak or strong, you know love is what we're after. We're all broken, but we're all in this together. God knows we stumble and we fall. And he's so loved the world, he sent his son to save us all. And all the people said amen. Oh, 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 oh. And all the people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord, for his love never ends. And all the people said amen. Blessed are the poor in spirit who are torn apart. Blessed are the persecuted and the pure in heart. Blessed are the people hungry for another start. For theirs is the kingdom of God. Lift it up. And all the people said amen. Oh, 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 and all the people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord, for his love never ends. And all the people said amen. And all the people said amen.
Amen. Be seated for just a minute. Share a couple of announcements with you, and then we'll have a time of prayer together. So by way of announcements, first, thank you to the Burbos for hosting last night a movie night for our young people, and thank you for those who were able to come out. We had a good time. If you weren't able to make it, we're going to plan another one for next month, so be watching your email, and we'll announce on Sunday morning for that, let you guys know when that's coming again. We are going to have a baptism service coming soon. We don't have a date plan yet, but I mention that today because of this. If you need to be baptized, if you've trusted in Christ and you've yet to follow that in believer's baptism, then we'd love to talk with you while we're planning this. It's probably going to be towards the middle or end of next month, October. We'll have a baptism service together. We've got a few folks who are going to be baptized already. If you want to know more about church membership, that's also a question that you can just share with me and we can talk about that. We're always happy to plan. We usually do just a brief lunch one Sunday morning afterwards and talk a little bit through church membership and what we believe as a church and what it takes to become a part of the covenant community here. Obviously, we've talked about that this morning. That's all I have for announcements. We have some prayer requests already. One was shared with me yesterday. You guys don't know Alan and Joyce Paris. They're friends of mine, and Joey knows them. Some of you know them. They live down in the Keys. Joyce lost her sister in a fight with cancer yesterday, and we just want to be praying for their family. They're up in Michigan, and so they're separated by many miles through this difficult time, and he asked me to be praying for them this morning, so we certainly will do that. I've got the list from last week up here. Kevin, we were praying for your friend Byron. Is there any update there, anything you want to share? Are we?
Things were going well enough that he wanted to get into looking at all of the accounts for his work. So, you know,
it's a good sign.
Right, exactly. So.
For a man, that means he's almost healed.
Right.
Good deal.
I do have another one to add.
Okay, please.
So, I have another friend in the same circle of friends. Donna is her name. And just heard this morning that she'd gone to the doctor and some test results have come back that her liver function isn't right, and the doctor believes that it may be hepatitis.
Mm.
So just that's really all we know right now, but she certainly okay. needs to be in our prayers.
Yeah, we'll pray for Donna. Thank you. Thank you. Gary, we prayed for your mom who was to have a surgery. Great. Very good. Very good. Thank you for the good report on Miss Raynell. That's wonderful news. And what else? What other prayer requests, Miss Kathy?
We do want to continue to pray for the folks in Louisiana and Lake Charles, and praise for Bethany is returning home tomorrow.
Oh, good. Very good.
New floors, new ceilings, new roof.
Great. And I saw that the church has found a place to gather with another local church there, I guess, close by in the area.
Their church still has a lot of repairs to
good.
Do.
Well, praise the Lord for his grace so far, and we'll keep praying for more and continued provision there. Thank you. Other prayer requests, other praises you want to share, Cheryl?
Yeah, Aaron, if you would
Susan?
She's battling pancreatic cancer.
Oh, wow. We will certainly pray for her. Thank you.
I'm thinking about the Covington family.
Yeah.
Praying for them. I miss seeing them at church.
Absolutely. We want to pray for Steve and Susie. I got to see Steve a couple of weeks ago, and I know, Matt, you've been talking to him a bit this week. We want to continue to pray for them. I know Miss Susie's still facing some health challenges and waiting on some answers, so keep praying for them. We definitely would love to see them back again soon. Yep. Thank you. Any other prayer requests? Any other praises? All right, let's go to God in prayer together. Father, we thank you so much for your grace and kindness to us. And we thank you that in the case of each of these that we've lifted up to you, God, you hear our prayers and you respond to them in your perfect wisdom and your perfect grace and your perfect love and kindness to us. And God, even at times when you don't give us what we ask for, you give us what is right and good and needful. And so we thank you for that, Father. I thank you for a couple of good reports this week from things we prayed over last week. I thank you, God, for the good news with Miss Raynell and that everything went well with her procedure. I pray you continue to guard her health and in her heart, God, and love her. I pray and thank you also for Kevin's friend, who is home now, and Byron, I just thank you, God, that you've been at work there and you're restoring his strength and his desire to get back to those ordinary things of life. I pray you continue to show your grace in that situation as well. And God, I lift up his friend Donna, who is facing some health challenges, as well as Miss Susan, who's suffering through cancer right now, and Miss Susie Covington as well, and Steve. God, I just pray for these who are sick. Most importantly, that in this time where their bodies are not perfectly well, God, that their soul and spirit would trust in you alone. We have nothing more needful in this life, God, than that we would find complete confidence in you. And so I pray, God, that they would know their nearness to you, that you are near to the brokenhearted. You are near to those who are suffering. You are near to those who are afflicted. And I pray they'd find comfort in that. God, I pray for the Paris family. I pray for Joyce and for the family of her dear sister. And God, I just pray you'd comfort them in this time of grief. I pray, God, that you would encourage them with the good news of Jesus Christ. Encourage them with the hope of the resurrection, that each of us who trust in Christ can look to an eternal resurrection and an eternal life with you for all eternity. Father, in all these things, what we desire most is your glory, that your name would be exalted. I pray for this people, God, of Redeemer Community Church, that you would strengthen us and send us forth as witnesses who can testify to the goodness of our God, to his power over sin in our life, to his power over all things, and to his power to save to the uttermost those who trust in him. So, Father, send us from this place today, bringing glory and honor to your name, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Benediction this morning from Numbers chapter 6, again, 24 through 26. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you peace. You're dismissed.